heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Body, and all members have not the same office,
So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Here ended the epistle.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty,
Of all, is the most remarkable in many ways, the almost arrogant response of the not quite teenage Jesus to his mother, that they really didn't understand what he was going on about. It was about his father's business, and they should have jolly well accepted it. How have we heard that so many times in various forms? There was a wonderful domesticity to it all, which only goes to underline the reality of the incarnation. That Jesus was not beyond believing, as most boys of his age do, when he thought he knew better than mum and dad. Well, of course, that is the point of Luke's primary purpose in recording the story, is debatable. Those of whom he had been found were far more impressed by the precocious boy's knowledge, his being able to handle the debate of theological matters, not just as an adult, but as one who knew what he was actually talking about. That is the main thrust. There is a further epiphany, an epiphany of one who is clearly not the usual kid from a backwater town in the north, but someone who was something of a prodigy. The reader of the Gospel, of course, knows the truth, which is, for good measure, revealed in Jesus' riposte to his slightly worried, yet relieved mother. He was doing something far more important than they could possibly understand. He was going about his father's business. But this was not the only time that Jesus spoke to his mother in such a fashion. There are several records in the Gospel. In another passage, which reveals more than perhaps the evangelist might have thought, Jesus is served out by his mother and siblings, who were slightly worried about the path that he was appearing to be going down. And they don't need to be told when they were outside, and even in no uncertain terms whatsoever, that Jesus' friends were also his mother, brother, and sisters. Again, this is not exactly a picture of happy families in the Waltons, but very much a human one. This time, Jesus is actually the adult who perhaps is not being allowed to grow up. But nevertheless, the reaction is the same. Mother, leave me alone. I'm grown up now. Does all this really matter? Well, of course it does. Not only does it indicate the importance of inclusion in Jesus' ministry, the inclusion of friendship, and the implications thereof, but also how earthly tension and harmless misunderstanding can, if properly handled, lead to a better and more fulfilling relationship. St. Luke comments here and elsewhere that Mary treasured these things in her heart. She stored them up, as one might a photo album or drawings made by children or grandchildren. Yes, in losing her son for a few days, it was not something that she would particularly have relished or particularly wanted to repeat, nor indeed receiving a telling off rather than the apology when he was found. But as is so often the case with these traumas, these can lead to being the very foundations upon which a more understanding relationship is formed. It's part of the growing up of both child and parents that both need to accept. It is not the argument that needs to be disrupted, or indeed debate. It is rather how these arguments and debates are handled. One of the problems, I think, with the modern world is that we seem to be losing the ability for good disagreements. Just because one might have sometimes a very radical divergence of opinion from our friends or those around us, that does not necessarily mean that our opponents are completely wrong. Indeed, if we went through life avoiding any expression of belief or understanding or thought that diverged in any way from our own, we would never ever encounter anything new, neither would we learn anything. This goes as much for faith as it does for politics or academic debate. Since a firm faith should be more than robust enough to stand up to challenges, even if those challenges can, which inevitably is the case on social media, be less than polite. It is belief that is built upon the sand that That requires a shouting down, a vilification of the opponent, rather than careful and prayerful persuasion and explanation. Yes, of course, our challenger may not themselves listen, another evident problem with the world, I fear, of 2021. But that does not mean that we should not do likewise. If we can take away something today from the events that happened in Washington this week, and indeed elsewhere last year, I think it's the need for loving debate and good disagreements. For the latter is very much a feature of our human being. Whilst we are all equal in the sight of God, all being made in his image, as it were, being who we are, that does not mean that we are all the same. Indeed, we cannot all be the same, because God, in his very essence of being Trinity, is in himself that diversity that is contained amongst the unity. And it is in those differences that we should ourselves flourish, while simultaneously recognising that which unites. That is how humanity essentially thrives, on the exciting God-given frisson that comes from our difference and similarity. It is that, then, where we have the Holy Family as our guide. It is holy because, for all intents and purposes, it was actually essentially very normal too. As well as being the precocious teenage doctor of theology, the boy Jesus, like many child prodigies, would have spent most of his time doing what other boys did. He was probably quite normal. He was one of us, like us. And again, this raises hope for us who at this moment in time may feel that we are caught very much in the valley of the shadow of death. Our frustrations, our dashed expectations, our weary trudging and ploughing through what is, let's face it, quite a challenge. All of these experiences are not beyond those of the Godhead. As with our debates, arguments, disagreements with family, friends, and fellow work, they are, in fact, at the very heart of it. Let your light so shine before them that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Thank you.
thanks to God for his many mercies and for bringing us safely to the beginning of this day. We pray for our community here at Hampton Court, for all who live and work here. We pray for our congregation, many of whom will be watching this at home. We pray that we may keep safe, and we pray for an end to this pandemic and for the rolling out of the vaccine. We pray for all those who work in the health service and frontline and key workers, those who put their lives at risk for others. We pray for the leaders of the nation. We pray for the people of America at this time. We pray for all those who are engaged in disagreement, that they may listen and learn and understand from one another. We pray for those who are sick in body, mind or spirit, particularly from our own congregation, for Jane, Anne Neal, Stephen David Portsmouth, Audrey Phillips, Liz Vaughan Hughes, Anthony Graham, Elizabeth English, Alexander Gordon Smith, Malcolm Hill, Margaret Chung, and Lynn Morley. And for those who have died, remembering especially Martin McKenna, who has died recently, for all those who have died from coronavirus or associated diseases, those who have died alone through violence, and those who have no one to pray for, that they may rest with Christ and rise with him in glory. And at this time of the anniversaries for John Farr, Geoffrey Hutton, Ethel Betty Buckingham, and Anne Dunn, that they may rise with Christ and reign with him the angels forever. Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications, and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy words and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, and especially thy servant Elizabeth, our Queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed. And grant unto her whole counsel, and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and indifferently minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may both, by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and specially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Even do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Almighty God,
and our hearts be sorry for these sad mysteries.
of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ said unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying of worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there by his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants entirely deserve thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may attain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offences through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee.
O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen.
As our Saviour Christ hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, ever and ever. Amen.
Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee, for that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who have duly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. In Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end.
Amen.
Gloria in excelsis Deo.
God, with passable understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you, and remain with you always.
Amen.
In the peace of Christ.